Samuel Dashiell Hammett was born in Maryland in 1894. He left school at 14 and after several menial jobs became an operative with Pinkerton's detective agency. During military service in the First World War, he contracted tuberculosis, which affected his health for the rest of his life. While in hospital, he met and married a nurse, Josephine Dolan, known as Josie, with whom he had two daughters. But forced by his illness to live apart, the marriage failed. He started writing in the 1920s for the pulp crime magazine The Black Mask, and was largely responsible for the creation of the hard-boiled genre of crime fiction. His productive writing career lasted less than a decade, during which he produced over 80 short stories and 5 novels, Red Harvest and The Dane Curse, both in 1929, The Maltese Falcon in 1930, The Glass Key in 1931, and The Thin Man in 1934. Today both Red Harvest and The Maltese Falcon are widely regarded as two of the greatest crime novels ever written. After service in the Second World War, he became involved in civil rights activities and, forced to appear before the House of Un-American Activities, served a prison term for contempt of court. He died in New York in 1961 and was buried in Arlington National Cemetery. In 1941, John Huston adapted and directed the now classic film version of The Maltese Falcon, with Humphrey Bogart in the role of the detective Sam Spade. It was in fact the third version of the novel to be filmed, and the most faithful, retaining much of the original dialogue. If there is anyone unfamiliar with the novel and film, it concerns the search for a jewel-encrusted figurine, the Maltese Falcon of the title, by a disparate group of crooks. They comprise of Casper Gutman, played by Sidney Greenstreet, Joel Cairo, played by Peter Lorre, Bridget O'Shaughnessy, played by Mary Astor, and Wilma Cook, played by Elisha Cook Jr. Miss O'Shaughnessy hires the private detective Sam Spade with a concocted story, and when his partner Miles Archer is killed, Spade comes under suspicion and is forced to find his partner's killer and clear his own name. The statue is revealed to be a fake, and the group resolve to set off in search of the genuine Falcon, but Spade turns them all into the police. The major change Huston made was to cut the entire Flitcraft episode, where the detective Sam Spade tells Bridget O'Shaughnessy about a thing that had happened some years before in the Northwest. The episode, or parable as some describe it, is for me and others the most extraordinary passage in any crime novel. I deeply regretted its omission from the film, as I saw it as being central to the meaning of the novel. I even entertained the hopeless fancy that it had actually been shot and had ended up on the cutting room floor, and that one day it would be rediscovered and restored. But it could never have survived the demands for a tightly plotted narrative. It would have constituted a 7 or 8 minute film within a film, a complete break in the narrative that works in the novel but could never have been countenanced in a Hollywood film of the period. All we can do now is read it and imagine. A man named Flitcraft had left his real estate office in Tacoma to go to luncheon one day and had never returned. He did not keep an engagement to play golf after 4 that afternoon, though he had taken the initiative in making the engagement less than half an hour before he went out to luncheon. His wife and children never saw him again. His wife and he were supposed to be on the best of terms. He had 2 children, boys, 1 5 and the other 3. He owned a house in a Tacoma suburb, a new Packard, and the rest of the appurtenances of successful American living. Flitcraft had inherited $70,000 from his father, and with his success in real estate was worth something in the neighborhood of $200,000 at the time he vanished. His affairs were in order, though there were enough loose ends to indicate that he had not been settling them in order preparatory to vanishing. A deal that would have brought him an attractive profit, for instance, was to have been concluded the day after the one in which he disappeared. There was nothing to suggest that he had more than $50 or $60 in his immediate possession at the time of his going. His habits, for months past, could be accounted for too thoroughly to justify any suspicion of secret vice, or even of another woman in his life, although either was barely possible. He went like that, Spade said, like a fist when you open your hand. Well, that was in 1922. In 1927, I was with one of the big detective agencies in Seattle. Mrs. Flitcraft came in and told us somebody had seen a man in Spokane who looked a lot like her husband. I went over there. It was Flitcraft, all right. He had been living in Spokane for a couple of years as Charles, that was his first name, Pierce. He had an automobile business that was netting him $20,000 or $25,000 a year, a wife, a baby son, owned his home in a Spokane suburb, and usually got away to play golf after 4 in the afternoon during the season. Spade had not been told very definitely what to do when he found Flitcraft. They talked in Spade's room at the Davenport. Flitcraft had no feelings of guilt. He had left his first family well provided for, and what he had done seemed to him perfectly reasonable. The only thing that bothered him was a doubt that he could make that reasonableness clear to Spade. He had never told anybody his story before, and thus had not had to attempt to make its reasonableness explicit. He tried now. "I got it all right," Spade told Bridget O'Shaughnessy, "but Mrs. Flitcraft never did. She thought it was silly." Maybe it was. Anyway, it came out all right. She didn't want any scandal, and after the trick he had played on her, the way she looked at it, she didn't want him. So they were divorced on the quiet, and everything was swell all around. Here's what happened to him. Going to lunch, he passed an office building that was being put up, just the skeleton. A beam or something fell 8 or 10 stories down and smacked the sidewalk alongside him. It brushed pretty close to him, but it didn't touch him, although a piece of the sidewalk was chipped off and flew up and hit his cheek. It only took a piece of skin off, but he still had the scar when I saw him. He rubbed it with his finger, while affectionately, when he told me about it. He was scared stiff, of course, he said, but he was more shocked than really frightened. He felt like somebody had taken the lid off life and let him look at the works. Flitcraft had been a good citizen and a good husband and father, not by any outer compulsion, but simply because he was a man most comfortable in step with his surroundings. He had been raised that way. The people he knew were like that. The life he knew was a clean, orderly, sane, responsible affair. Now a falling beam had shown him that life was fundamentally none of these things. He, the good citizen, husband, father, could be wiped out between office and restaurant by the accident of a falling beam. He knew then that men died at haphazard like that and lived only while blind chance spared them. It was not primarily the injustice that disturbed him. He accepted that after the first shock. What disturbed him was the discovery that insensibly ordering his affairs, he had got out of step and not in step with life. He said he knew before he had gone 20 feet from the fallen beam that he would never know peace until he had adjusted himself to this new glimpse of life. By the time he had eaten his luncheon, he had found his means of adjustment. Life could be ended for him at random by a falling beam. He would change his life at random by simply going away. He loved his family, he said, as much as he supposed was usual, but he knew that he was leaving them adequately provided for, and his love for them was not of the sort that would make absence painful. He went to Seattle that afternoon, Spade said, and from there by boat to San Francisco. For a couple of years he wandered around and then drifted back to the Northwest and settled in Spokane and got married. His second wife didn't look like the first, but they were more alike than they were different. You know, the kind of woman that play fair games of golf and bridge and like new salad recipes. He wasn't sorry for what he had done. It seemed reasonable enough to him. I don't think he ever knew he had settled back naturally in the same groove he had jumped out of in Tacoma, but that's the part of it I always liked. He adjusted himself to beams falling, and then no more of them fell, and he adjusted himself to them not falling. If you seek a key to the work, it strikes me that you need look no further than the novel's dedication to Josie. Josie, like Bridget O'Shaughnessy, of Irish-American heritage, was the wife who he left, like Flitcraft, when confronted with the falling beam in the form of the death sentence of tuberculosis. Like Flitcraft, he adjusted himself to beams falling, and then no more of them fell. The condition didn't prove fatal. And he adjusted himself to them not falling, and started a new life with a new wife. An article drew my attention to the fact that the alias Flitcraft assumes in his new life, albeit with a slightly different spelling, is the same as a distinguished American philosopher, without, however, offering any explanation of what significance that might have. I found out that Charles Sanders Peirce, 1839-1914, was a philosopher, logician, mathematician and scientist, noted among other things for his founding of pragmatism. Peirce's law states, this was quite incomprehensible to me, but when I came across what is known as Peirce's maxim, a tentative definition of pragmatism, it started to fall into place. It states, consider what effects that might conceivably have practical bearings we conceive the object of our conception to have. Then our conception of these effects is the whole of our conception of the object. This statement is central to the climax of the novel, when Spade forces a confession from Bridget O'Shaughnessy and explains the reasons for turning her in.
This won't do any good. You'll never understand me, but I'll try once and then give it up. If a man's partner's killed, he's supposed to do something about it. It doesn't make any difference what you thought of him. He was your partner and you're supposed to do something about it. And it happens we're in the detective business. Well, when one of your organization gets killed, it's bad business to let the killer get away with it. Bad all around. Bad for every detective everywhere.
You don't expect me to think of these things you're saying. Sufficient reason for sending me to this.
Wait till I'm through, then you can talk. I've no earthly reason to think I can trust you. And if I do this and get away with it, you'll have something on me that you can use whenever you want to. Since I've got something on you, I couldn't be sure that you wouldn't put a hole in me someday. All those are on one side. Maybe some of them are unimportant. I won't argue about that. But look at the number of them. What have we got on the other side? All we've got is that maybe you love me and maybe I love you.
You know whether you love me or not.
Maybe I do. I'll have some rotten nights after I sent you over with that advice. If all I've said doesn't mean anything to you, then forget it and we'll make it just this. I won't because all of me wants to, regardless of consequences. And because you counted on that with me, the same as you counted on that with all the others.
I read the passage to someone close to me, and when I had finished, she asked me what it meant. I did my best to explain, but like Mrs. Flitcraft, she didn't get it. She thought it was silly. Perhaps it was, but like Samuel Spade, I think I got it all right.